In this episode of Angling Archaeology, we're going to be reeling back the clock to the 1930s. Now, there's nothing depressing about these Depression-era fishing magazines. These 30s publications make the Roaring 20s look like the Boring 20s. Stick around, and we'll dive into these colorful classics and see what's inside. I'd like to start these, a couple quick little notes about the 1930s. A lot of things happened. You had the Great Depression. You had the Dust Bowl. You had the Social Security Act was enabled. The Hindenburg disaster. The beginning of World War II. The New Deal. Lots of things were going on in the 1930s. So with all that going on, people needed something to do, something to kick back, relax. So why not do a little bit of fishing? So let's explore these magazines, see how they did it and what they used. All right, we're going to start with the May 1931 Sportsmans Digest magazine. And wow, look at this cover. I mean, incredible artwork and graphics. If you were walking by a newsstand in 1931 and you saw this cover of a lion taking out a zebra, you'd stop and say, I got to see what's going on with this. I mean, just incredible artwork on this. Got to love that. Well, let's go ahead and jump right in. So like the April 1922 Sportsman's Digest that I went over in the last episode, this magazine is packed with a lot of articles, not a ton of advertising. However, they do a better job of advertising in this, as you can see with this full page ad right here of this large marbles hunting knife. Very cool. But we're gonna breeze through this one very quickly because the next magazine I wanna show is awesome. So this is the cover story right here of a person hunting. And we have a story here about trout fishing at Simpson Lake here in Wyoming. Very cool. As you can see right here, they're taking horses across to go trout fishing. Just really, really neat. So in this article here, we have a story about ice fishing. A lot of the stories in this magazine are kind of firsthand accounts of fishing tales. Like this one, for example, the fish that got away. Isn't that the story that's as old as time? I mean, I think everyone's heard that a thousand times. This one's about a rainbow trout that got away, although that's not a rainbow trout, so interesting that they used that photo. Moving on, here's an advertising right here for a floating injured minnow, creek chub. Gotta like that. This is neat. We'll stop right here for just 1 second. In the tackle kit, and this is, they call it spoon hooks and flashers, and what they mean by that are inline spinners. And these ones in particular are all made for pike. The article talks about pike fishing by using these inline spinners. And if you look down here, there's 7 different lures, but they're all Fluger or South Bend. But a pretty neat little article there. Now I'll be honest, I got this magazine because it was only $4, or else I probably wouldn't have got another Sportsman's Digest, just because there's not a lot of full color ads. But the cover was worth it. Okay, this is a pretty neat page as well too. Now, you get your free choice of anything on this page if you sign up for a subscription to Sportsman's Digest. So in 1931, these are the options, okay? What would you get? I'll try to raise that up so y'all can see it. See, I don't know. See, this is a tough decision for me. I mean, my mind first goes to creek chub. I'd probably go ahead and go for the pikey minnow, but man, maybe the fluger? I don't know. The arbogast? the weedless kicker? Comment down below. Let me know what you would do. I don't know. Probably a creek chub. And then it'd be a coin toss between the frog wiggler or the weedless kicker. Man, but that flugger, I don't know. So anyways, so that's this one. That's, I mean, and as I, this thing is so brittle, as I walked through it, it fell apart. So there it is. Here's a really nice full color advertising as well too for Reddington. And once again with this one as well too, it's got the original person's address on here. Very, very interesting that that's still there, and awesome that it survived that long. More or less, it just survived long enough for me to get my hands on it and then completely destroy it. So there you go. That's that. I'm gonna go ahead and put this in a plastic sleeve so I don't ruin it even more. And we're gonna move on to the next one. Now we're moving on to the May 1935 Outdoor Life magazine right here. Now, in my opinion, Outdoor Life is like the top shelf Cadillac of the vintage magazine world. First, we need to stop and pause and look at this incredible artwork right here. You have a guy here getting a bass with which appears to be kind of a head and slope nose. It's not exactly a slope nose, but you can tell what he's fishing with. I mean, vivid colors, just eye-popping, incredible. And let me show you something else too. And that is this right here. Now that says NRA. Now that's not the NRA that you think of today. This is actually the National Recovery Act. And this was put into place in 1933 by Roosevelt to help during the Great Depression. And so more or less what it was is Congress passed this bill that companies would come together and help with things like labor law, whether that's, you know, a certain minimum wage or putting a cap on how many hours a week you could work. So it was helped to boost the economy. Well, for whatever reason, this particular legislation had disbanded in May of 1935. Now, I think there's some kind of form of it still even out there today. Obviously, there's regulations or whatever else. But the official NRA with the code on it right here, that only lasted a couple of years, to my knowledge. And I'll have to do some more research just to be 100% sure. But, I mean, that's kind of the cliff notes or the elevator pitch, if you will. And there's actually fishing lures back in the day that had this code on the box. So it's kind of like, hey, if you're part of this group, then, you know, you're really for America and you're here to help the working man. So pretty interesting to see that. So anyways, let's go ahead and move on and look through the magazine. Now, why I call this the quote-unquote Cadillac of outdoor magazines is that there is just a ton of advertising in here. And I'm going to be a lot more careful with this one than I was with the other one, just because these are more desirable, more expensive. But you can just see page one, you get right into a Lucky Strike ad, just full color, very vivid. Love that. And we also start to see something too here that we didn't see in the other ones is we start to see alcohol advertising. Obviously that was illegal until a couple years before. And so here we go. Crab Orchard, straight whiskey right there. Now it would take all day to go through this into detail, but I will just stop at the kind of the important parts here. But I just want you all to see this. It's really just fun to look back at all this. I mean, all these advertisements right here, there's just tons and tons, it's chock full of advertising. You know, bass fishing in Canada, there's a lot of resorts and cabins and things like that. We'll breeze through this quickly as well too, but I have to show you this. Look at this. Look at that airplane flying in to probably somewhere in Canada. This is the Cascades. Look at that guy fly fishing off that. And if you go to the next page here, look at these folks. It's not only just an old sketchy airplane, but they're all just fishing off the top of it. Pretty incredible stuff. Go through this pretty quick, got some bear hunting. This is a really awesome article I loved it. And it's a lot of education about how weather really affects fishing. And that goes into detail about storm fronts, temperatures, time of day, tide, all sorts of stuff. And, you know, maybe during this time, I think that maybe some of that was put into play, but this really goes into detail about why that's important. And, you know, the times to fish and when to try to avoid it when you can. Just very cool. And you got this really cool fish guy right here. Just trying to zoom in. He's like broadcasting over the radio. Just really neat artwork. Here's another good article right here too. This is about flies and specifically which flies work best for which kind of trout. So you have everything from stoneflies to caddises to dragonflies to mayflies, and who goes for what. So for example, it says right here the brown trout have a fondness for the caddis fly, and the adult mayflies are favored with brook trout and also eaten by rainbow. Well, let's be honest. I mean, a trout's really gonna eat any kind of bug. So they're gonna like all these, but it's interesting to see their take back on the day on what they thought was the best fly for the trout. It's nice to see that as we're moving through, that there's a lot more educational content rather than just like someone's story of how they did things. So here's another really interesting article right here, and this is about the fishing laws of 1935. And as we flip over here to Colorado, for example, I think we really start to see conservation kick off. It was discussed a little bit in the 1922 magazine that I discussed in my last episode, but this one, it's clear as day. It's like you can only catch a certain amount per day, and then they're really trying to avoid people fishing in the wintertime for whatever reason. And it says that the trout fishing is only allowed during May 25th through October 31st. Got fish on the brain. And if you look here, it's lakes 6,000 feet altitude or less, and streams 5,000 foot or less, you can start on April 10th. But anything outside of that, you have to start May 25th. Well, which is interesting because now you can fish year round, and some of the best fishing is actually in the wintertime fly fishing in Colorado. So it's kind of cool to see that back in the day, they were really trying to care for when people, you know, go out there and fish and it's not overcrowded and they're not taking all the trout out of there. So we'll go over to my neck of the woods over here real quick. We have Kansas, and not a whole lot of closed season here. Basically, you can catch fish year round. The only thing they have here is basically make sure you have a fishing license, and it's not required for, you know, females or males under 18 or over 70. And that rule for the under 18 and over 70, it's kind of still in place today, but really not a lot of rules. It's kind of get after it in Kansas. So pretty neat to look through it. Make sure you all see what's in this. Here's a really nice ad for South Bend right here. And it shows some reels, and then it also shows these lures. And I've always wondered how to say this. Just, you know, beep bop down below and let me know how to pronounce this. Is it a Reno or a Reno? Is it like Bassarino, Pikerino, Trixarino? I'm thinking like Beefarino, you know? Like, that's the way that I think it's pronounced, but I could be wrong. I actually found one of these fishing in a neighborhood lake. It was a wood one. It was original, old school. Could have been 30s or 40s. I'll have to track that down. Well, I couldn't help myself. I just went ahead and tracked it down anyways. So here you see it right here. But I found this fishing in a neighborhood pond. You can tell it's woods cracked right there. Looks like, you know, it's obviously, it's seen some use, but still very cool find. Just picked it up and I was like, it's a good find. I like to pause anytime we see Hedden. I just think Hedden has really cool advertising. I'm hoping that's showing up okay. Better than a bucket of live minnows. And then we also have the A.L. Foss company. What I like about this magazine as well too, and it's probably because it's the summertime or at least late spring, is that it's really heavy on the fishing. Now this This is the best ad in the whole magazine right here. You don't even have to know what era this is from just to know this is from the 30s. It just looks like the 30s. It's kind of got that 30s and 40s kind of have that like cartoony look. If you watch an old like Looney Tunes or something too, you kind of see a little bit of that in this as well. Super, super vivid. Very cool. I mean, just a simple ad, but like the lightning strike with, you know, the hue around it. You can tell that I geek out over these old ads. Just think it's just because they don't make ads like this anymore. Everything's all, I don't know, not as cool as this. Okay, there you have it. And then it ends right here with another Reddington ad, like some of, well, most of them do actually. They have full color Reddington ads in the back. So pretty cool. Well, that's going to do it for this episode of Angling Archaeology as we're reeling through the decades. Up next, we'll do the 1940s. So that'll be pretty exciting. And as we reel through the decades, you'll start to see that these magazines are more colorful, vibrant, the advertising's better. So it just gets better and better. Quick note over there, got the Outdoor Life magazine proudly displayed, and I put this one in a protective cover because it's only been around for 90 years and it took me 5 minutes to destroy it. So, oops. So again, that's going to do it for this episode of Angling Archaeology, where we unearth the good old days. So thanks for watching. Until next time, we'll see you on the water.